So there you have your answer. Let's talk about the big buzzkill in today's session. Certainly that was the financials, the group accelerating their losses following a note by Calian Securities' Mike Mayo saying he expects Citi to have $10 billion in fourth quarter write-downs. With his thoughts is Chris Whalen, Managing Director of Institutional Risk Analytics. Chris, always good to have you with us.
Hey, good to be back.
The note specifically mentions $10 billion in fourth quarter write-down of deferred tax assets. Normally deferred, and correct me if I'm wrong, normally deferred tax assets, not a problem unless you believe that the company cannot earn their way out.
Well, that's correct. I mean, the management of the company takes a view on the tax asset, but then they have to look at their auditor, and the auditor has to agree with them. So you have a situation at Citi. We all know about the tax asset, by the way. This is not a new issue. But I think what Michael did very appropriately was remind everybody of reality. There's enormous denial right now when it comes to financials, both with respect to issues like this, on intangible, off-balance sheet exposures, as we talked about before. So he kind of woke everybody up a little bit, and I think we're going to see more of this as we go into the new year.
Christopher, it's Karen. What about today made him do that? Is there anything specific? Are they starting to have year-end discussions with their auditors now? I didn't see any particular filings today.
No, you won't. Yeah, you won't see the paper on this, Karen, until next year. But what happens is the auditors have to start the conversation now. And it will be a process that actually takes almost 5 months between the close of the year end and when they actually drop the K coming up on the annual meeting. And it takes a long time. In fact, sometimes the auditors actually can't get the work done by the time that the K has to be filed, and they have to drop an amendment before their annual meeting.
Does $10 billion look like a correct number in your view?
Well, yes, and it's complicated because you have both U.S. tax assets and foreign tax assets. They've got about $38 billion on the books now, and 10, I think, is a reasonable write-off. I mean, when do we think Citi is going to be profitable again? That's the question. And I, you know, to me, like I say, this is not a new issue, but Michael, I think, really refocused everybody's attention on the fact that there's $40 billion worth of tax intangibles on Citi's books that, you know, arguably you could write the whole thing off.
Hey, Chris, it's Joe. Citi only put $802 million into loan loss reserves in the last quarterly earnings report. Do you think that was too little? Do you think they're under-reserved now going forward in 2010?
Oh, of course. Everybody's under reserve. Look, you have to remember, the stress tests that the Fed did were pegged on Q3. You had to do well on Q3 with what they call pre-provision revenue in order to qualify and show them that you've hit the mark. You've got capital plus pre-provision revenue equals the loss estimate for the bank. That's the formula that the Fed's using. So everybody did well in the third quarter because they had to. This is yet another head fake, by the way.
Chris, you had mentioned before that this certainly is not a new concern. And in fact, I've got an article from American Banker written at the end of last month, which also highlights some other of the banks out there which have potentially huge deferred tax assets. Are there any other concerns out there do you think that investors are not paying attention to when it comes to the likes of perhaps a Bank of America or a Wells Fargo or a PNC?
Well, with Bank America and Wells, you have off-balance sheet. I mean, if you looked at Wells' earnings release, they're bringing $28 billion in off-balance sheet on balance sheet, but they're only talking about variable interest entities. They're not even talking about all of the QSPEs that the FASB is going to get rid of at the end of the year. We're playing a game. Eventually, the banks are going to have to address this issue, but they don't have to until the end of the year. And so the entire investment community, I think, is sleepwalking when it comes to the accounting issues of the banks. It's quite amazing.
So, Christopher, it's Karen. Then a way to solve this would be to issue equity. Do you see Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Citi doing that?
Well, the funny, you ask a very good question, Karen. They should have been issuing equity now. This was their window. We've been in the eye of the hurricane for the last 4 months. In August, when you saw volatility for this group drop below 100%, that was the calm. This was the time to raise capital, but they don't want to do that. They're all pretending everything's fine. My view is that they should have raised capital now because next year is going to be tough.
All right, Chris, always great to speak with you. Thank you very much for your analysis on this topic, which really took the markets, not by surprise, but really refocused, as you said, the conversation.
Look, amen. We've been talking about shorting the bank stocks. Wells Fargo report on October 21st. We said that day, you know, bail out of this thing. If anything, if you want to be aggressive, get short. I still think you can get short Wells Fargo. Look at that day. Traded 113 million shares that day. Trade up to 31.12. You squeezed out all the shorts. It's going down. Go back to the UBS analyst comments, $20 price target. Beauvais says 25. I agree. And if these guys, I mean, they keep saying they're going to pay back the TARP in a shareholder-friendly way, I would like to see it. I still think it's secondary.
Back in the spring, we were talking about good bank, bad bank, and we were really analyzing balance sheets. I think it's time to do that again. I think that's what this earnings season has shown you. You have to look at the commercial banking sector and say, okay, who's got the strong balance sheet? You look at that. A name like J.P. Morgan clearly stands out. They are clearly best in breed. The rest of those names, they are clearly suspect when you look at what they have in terms of withstanding for the right.
What are some of the other opportunities? Because let's focus on the opportunities come Monday, because this whole sector sold off, but of course not everybody is like a Citibank or Wells Fargo.
Well, I mean,
or Bank
when you talk about opportunities, yeah. You can a short is an opportunity. Now, unfortunately,
right,
people
true.
Don't like to play it that way, but that's what I'm seeing as opportunity right now. If you want to stay on the sidelines, that's fine as well. But if you're going to buy the dip on Monday, I think you're stepping into something. It's not unlike buying RIM after they reported at 73.
So Goldman Sachs at a 170 is not attractive.
No, I don't think so. Because okay. I think the tape's
and
going
the
down.
Other thing that was big news today was the talk about the commercial real estate section. You had every big market mogul out there talking it down. And if you look at some of the regional banks that we've talked about on the show having the most exposure, they actually held in somewhat, you know, reasonably well. But if you look at the RKH, which is the regional bank ETF, this was down 5%. That may be also telling you about the next move here. I think Monday you're going to see more follow through on this rhetoric from, again, George Soros, Wilbur Ross, Mohammed El-Erian. All these guys were talking about commercial real estate.
And I think Monday's going to be a bad day, but let's not. Clearly, Goldman Sachs is the first place that you want to look. It's the capital markets play, and that's one of the first names that you do want to buy when you feel like the market's kind of stabilized.
Karen, are you getting a little bit worried about your Bank of America holdings?
No, I mean, I look at it as I'm a long-term investor. Yeah. Clearly, this has been a terrible week for Bank of America, but it doesn't really change my outlook. We actually, you know, we have been short BB&T through puts. Mm-hmm. We sold some of those today, which is the same as getting long. So, I mean, I think the commercial real estate story is not new at all.
Yeah.
It was interesting, though, that they all talked about it today. Why is that?
I don't know if it was the commercial real estate bear meeting. I don't really know what was happening yeah. today.
The Association
but
of Commercial
I don't know,
is
Wilbur Ross, does he want to be a sort of a vulture commercial real estate investor? I mean, there's tons right. of money out there that is looking yeah. to capitalize on the downturn in commercial real estate. Tons.
You want to look to the trigger, though, for the down move. And I think we sort of talked about it that night. Go back to CSX when they reported earnings earlier this month. We talked about EPS they beat, but we said, guess what? They missed on the rev side, and it wasn't as big a beat as we've seen in prior quarters. Those stocks have gotten crushed. Now, BNI on Friday, last Friday, obliterated. People didn't want to look at the signs. You have to look at the signs. The transports will lead. Look at the double top in CSX. If these continue to go lower, the market will continue to
go
lower.
And also, it's important to understand what's going to go on this weekend around the tables across America. Is the conversation, is it time to pull out of the market? Is the market over? How deep is this going to be? Is the top in, or is it a correction? I think here what you have to anticipate is a very, very weak tape on Monday, and you have to see how you navigate your way through the ISM, FOMC, and unemployment next week. If we come out of next week unscathed, then this is nothing more than a nominal pullback of maybe 5 to 8%.
Let's delve deeper into one sector of the market that fell today, and we have been talking about as potentially an area of breakdown when it comes to market leadership. And in fact, take a look at the chart on Apple, because Apple giving up all of its gains basically from when the time it reported earnings.